Oedd noswaith dda. Croeso I sgwrs arall gan Ffoton gyda Dan Wood. A warm welcome to another Ffoton conversation, this time with the lovely Dan Wood, who you see here. It's a great pleasure actually talking to Dan. We had a wonderful Ffoton conversation with him. If you want a really lengthy, in-depth conversation, please listen.
I apologise in advance.
We had a wonderful time in his house talking about his work. And I guess we'll start off with a bit of a précis of the suicide machine, really, and where it all came from, I suppose, Dan?
I hope I don't say basically too many times tonight.
That's okay.
It all started, acquired a Hasselblad square format camera, and I'd been shooting black and white relentlessly for many years, and I thought to myself, well, I really fancy shooting some medium format, why not do it in colour? So then I kind of thought to myself, well, I'll do something skateboard related, maybe some of the areas in town where skaters frequent, you know, and some portraits, blah blah blah. Anyway, because I'd already kind of done the skateboarding thing, it was kind of, nah, I have to do something completely new. So it was then I decided to, right, I'm going to do something about Bridgend, of all places. And I thought, well, I came up with the title first before I'd even started shooting, to tell the truth. So I knew it was going to be kind of suicide related, but how deep I was going to go into that would be something I'd find out along the way. So I nearly said basically again. So I just started shooting with this Hasselblad. But at first I went round some of the notorious areas where some of the suicides are taking place. And it just didn't feel right. I just felt, it felt too far gone and that I shouldn't really be doing it. And anyway, the narrative started changing the more I started thinking about things. And then my wife became pregnant with our first child. And that's when the narrative completely changed. And I thought, you know, well, this is more about now what kind of town our daughter's going to be growing up in. So, and then that's where it went from there.
So Bridgend became your palette. The actual title itself was sparked by a visit at Gatwick Airport.
Yeah, because we were, I forget where we were going, Vietnam? Yeah, Vietnam. And the girl checking in said, she saw the passport and she said, Bridgend, that's where all the suicides are. And I thought, hang on. Is that the only thing we're famous for in Bridgend? So that contributed to it a lot, you know.
Yeah, and the other thing that I find really fascinating about the project is that you didn't wandify. All this stuff was on your doorstep.
It was.
Did you find it enlightening wandering around Bridgend and not going to these difficult areas, but just wandering the town and wandering the area?
It was something I absolutely loved doing, and I really miss it. On a Tuesday and a Wednesday, I worked for my dad, just to earn a few quid, and so I'd leave the house 6:30 in the morning, and I'd wander around town for 20 minutes, especially when the light was nice, and you know, the winter months not so much, but especially in the summer months, I just go wandering around and all over the place just to see what I could find. It was always something.
would you like to show some people some of the work from the book itself? I love the cover, and you had a great input into the cover.
I did. I managed to twist the Ian from Another Place Press's arm to give me that cover, because I think either he had a red one with the white writing or a full bleed picture, and I wasn't really feeling that, to tell the truth. This is one of the earlier pictures. I spoke about this in my Ffoton 5-minute-y thing.
Yeah, the one image, yeah.
Yeah, that's it. And this was basically about vulnerability and responsibility. So, and it was also one of the first shots I took after buying the Mamiya 6, which changed everything in itself then, because it was much easier to use than the Hasselblad. Another one of the very early ones, this kind of says a lot to me, because, you know, you almost wonder if the, well, it basically says there's people out there now still in kind of a trouble with suffering mentally and stuff like that. It's not your regular piece of graffiti, that. And no. It was next to the college, near, just around the corner from where you guys live. And I think that this was on the first roll of film I shot for the project. And it was a good trigger to, I knew what I wanted to do then with the project after seeing that. So I went from there, basically.
It's very evocative, that, actually.
Yeah, and it's gone now, but I hope the person who wrote it is okay. But the project itself is also a protest project against Bridgend Council, because nothing's ever straightforward to them. I'm sure lots of towns are the same, but they make lives difficult for everyone, and they seem to enjoy it, And this guy, it's all true, John. This guy who owns this building. It's right opposite the council offices, and I think they wanted him to tidy the building up, or paint it or whatever. And it's well within his rights, apparently, that he doesn't have to. So he stuck those smiley emojis. Is that the word?
Yeah.
In the window, staring directly at the council offices as a big kind of. And, I suppose they'll probably have the last laugh, but as they always do. I've no idea. I haven't got much to tell you about this, to tell the truth, but it's just a giant discarded ice cream among some bins. I'm sure it was something to do with the food festival. But the way it's kind of just thrown, put in amongst the bins, as if, no one's going to even notice it.
Yeah.
But it's all about things being discarded, I'm sure they're going to use that again for something, But just easy come, easy go, What's the next one? This is one of the early ones too. I kind of knew this guy anyway, so he's like, yeah, I go shoot my gun every Sunday, shooting pigeons or whatever. I'm like, are you allowed to do that? Yeah. I said, I wouldn't mind taking a portrait of you. Oh yeah, brilliant. Come down and where I go. It's in the old Island Farm, where the prisoner of war camp was.
Yeah.
So it was a Sunday morning, I think, and my phone went, it's just a text, I'm going down to shoot my gun. So I thought, I think I'd had some wine the night before, so I was just like, okay, let's go and find this guy with his gun. So jumped in the car, drove down there, didn't arrange to meet him anywhere, so he could have been anywhere. I was just like, he's in bloody camouflage as well. So I was wandering about, just really paranoid. It was creepy. And I was like, Mark, Mark. Nothing. And with that, he just kind of came out of the bushes with his gun. I was like, jeez. He's like, oh, all right then. You found me all right then. And I said, yeah. So we went onto this little patch of land, and that's out of the roll of film I took. That was the first shot. It was just like that. And then he started getting a bit silly then. He was lying on the ground doing sniper poses, and he was kind of like, I could show you the rest of them and you'd laugh.
But it actually looks like he's just found the gun, actually, isn't it?
He was just getting ready to put his show on, you know. Yeah. He was. So I'm glad I pressed the shutter then, because after that it just got a bit ridiculous, you know. He had this kind of trapper hat as well with the flaps, and it was such a surreal 3/4 hour. But a nice enough guy. Yeah. What's next? Oh, I can press on. This, another early one actually, with the Hasselblad. I was always all right with the Hasselblad when you were shooting kind of like F8 to F22. Yeah, yeah. It was after that, my eyes used to let me down with the focus, especially with a 2.8. I couldn't get anything in focus with it. That's why I switched to the Mamiya 6 with a rangefinder. But this, I was interested, you know, this is about community and the way you just lock yourself away these days. You know, in our last house, it was pretty similar to that. We just shut the front door and we wouldn't see anyone then. And I just think that it's typical of communities today, you know. We put a big fence around, there's paranoia. Oh, God, the immigrants are going to be climbing over our fence. Yeah. And that's basically what that picture's all to do with, just paranoia. It's called Fortified House. And funnily enough, we drove past it and maybe recently, and it just still looks exactly the same 3 years later. Bargain booze. This was one of my early morning struts around Bridgend. I actually had to handhold this at like a quarter of a second.
Wow.
Check that out. I never take a tripod anyway. I'm like, no. But it is sharper on the screen if you don't believe me. But this is kind of the, it's almost like a holy building, isn't it? You know, people just flock to this place.
Yeah.
And it's right on the route home from work, so.
Busy store.
Yeah, yeah. I'm in there all the time. Now, their red wine selection's not that good, so we don't go there much, do we? But yeah, so it was unusual for there not to be any cars, because there's always cars parked in this car park.
The interesting thing, do you, prior to taking these shots, are these places in your head already, and you think, maybe I'd like to go there, or I'd like to do that shot?
Yeah, sometimes. And sometimes I have to revisit for the right light, and I'll work out the time of day, or I'll even look on Google Maps and predict where the sun's going to be, and I know it's all right to go. So, yeah. But I think this was just a chance walk past one morning.
But that attention to detail is really, really important, because your work, I mean, we were talking earlier about the geometry of your pictures.
Oh, yeah.
And how important the horizontals and the verticals
are.
Yeah.
It was important to kind of include these parking space lines. You know, I wanted that in, and even the lamppost, I suppose, does something. But geometry, and, well, I was going through a phase of putting everything in the center of the screen as well. It works better, I think, with 6x6 format.
Right.
So, geometry. It's all about the geometry. where do we know? Oh, this one, it's just a piece of polythene that was literally there for months and months and months, flapping about in the wind. I used to walk past this a few times a week. I think that piece of polythene is still bloody there. But the irony of this is, there was a council is a toilet block with a council stores on the side, where the guys who sweep the streets base themselves. So this was there for months, and it's flapping about everywhere, and they don't even see it, you know. And I just think that's pretty symbolic of just blinkers on, staring at the ground, picking up the fag ends, and then they've got this ugly old thing. I liked it anyway, so.
Yeah.
But there we go. My mother doesn't get that picture at all, by the way. I suppose this is Yolo. Some of you probably know him. He's a major figure in Bridgend, you know. He's a jewellery maker. He's got a shop on the old stone bridge, which you can see in the background. Mm. And he's a musician and brilliant artist. He's just a real gifted person. And I was walking with him to his shop because we were discussing wedding rings, because we decided to get married last year. And the light was great, and I said, "Oh, just let me," because that's one of the classic shots of Bridgend. That is, and the light was good, so I just took just one frame. I think it was the last frame on a roll of film, and I just thought that he kind of represents the under 40s in Bridgend. Everyone knows Yolo,
right?
So. He's there eating his little pot of rice and his carrier bag full of Welsh cakes. On to this one now. This is interesting. I just, when I see these guys in town, it kind of makes me think as if they're kind of preying on the weak, you know. Bridgend, they've had a lot of problems there.
Yes.
They need our help. Let's take this big, massive cross to show them. And the guy on the right wasn't even that friendly. He was he was quite obnoxious. And
quiet.
He was very obnoxious. The guy on the left was
Did he not want to have his photograph taken?
No, they were fine with it. But I don't like that kind of pushing evangelism down vulnerable people's throats, you know?
Yeah.
Let them find out for themselves. I was with, I don't know if you know the photographer, Anthony Stokes.
Yeah.
Did the Valleys book.
Yeah, yeah.
I was with him at the time I took that. And that's an education in itself, being with him.
Would you like to expand it?
Well, I was involved in an exhibition with him the end of last year, was it? And he's quite eccentric. He caused the curators so many problems. Like, it was a 5-day exhibition, concertine boards, hang the pictures, get out of there after 5 days, you know? Oh no, not with Anthony. He wanted the whole place replastered, and he threw a massive spanner in the works, and God, in the end, we just ended up hammering nails into the wall. And but one of the first meetings we went to, I apologize in advance for this story, but it's his fault. One of the first meetings we went to, the lady said, can you bring some work in to the first meeting? Yes, yeah, examples of your work, blah blah blah. So we're all there. This is, I brought some stuff in for you to look at. Anthony, I've started a new project. I think you might be interested. It's called Penises of Bridgend. He had this whole body of work that he brought in of just these like schoolboy graffiti penises from every corner of Bridgend and had them printed out. Lay them on the table. The girl in charge of the Carnegie house, she nearly fell off her chair. It was And then straight away then they knew that they were going to have problems with this guy. And they did. But I'm glad he was there.
Did you watch these guys work at all? Or was it that posed picture was the only picture you took of these guys?
That was the only picture I took of them. But I did see them work and stood and was kind of then, oh, I've got to take a picture of this. And it was, the last frame on the roll of film. Because there's only 12 shots.
Yeah.
So I was always on the last bloody shot every time. So it was one shot. So it looks like the guy on the left is blinking, but he definitely isn't.
Okay.
This is just about the ongoing regeneration in Bridgend. You know?
Yeah.
These guys will know themselves. It's just, there's no end to it. Just one thing after another. They put a whole, new road in there. And then a year later, they're digging it all back up because they're going to build a new building. It's just, so I kept seeing this. I thought there's a shot there. And I was looking at it from every angle. And then one day I noticed this diagonal. But I didn't have my camera that day. So I had to re-wait for the diagonal to appear. But I knew the kind of time it would. And the sky, there was some rain that had just happened, I think. So yeah, this constant regeneration, that there's just, they don't know when to finish. Well, this is, I don't know whether this is a good thing or a bad thing. This is about the developers of Bridgend. They're called the Hegartys. And they do wonderful things. All EU money, they apply for these grants and then they give these buildings a facelift. So they buy the buildings and then they're left for sometimes up to 5 years, just decrepit. And then the money will come through and they'll do it up. And they just bought this building. So I don't know if, I keep touching it. I don't know if that graffiti was directed at them or it was already there, but there's definitely a coincidence there because they're definitely money orientated, but town is being developed slowly by them, I suppose.
It's a hell of a statement.
I know, I thought, you know, it's not some kid with nothing to do has written that, is it? It's just, and you know, that wall was about 6 or 7 foot, I suppose,
presumably it's disappeared by now, has it?
Yeah, I went past recently. I did cheat a bit with this, because this is in Southern Down. So, it kind of counts as Bridgend.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, this is about just cramming houses in it, on every little bit of land.
Yes.
They can, you know. It's just, that's a supermarket car park, I took that, and, you know, what a view. It's just, well, as my mother said, oh, that's a lovely place to live. And I'm just thinking, what? She says, you're right by Tesco's.
Do you show all your work to your mother?
She ends up seeing it somehow.
Right.
So, she is my main critic, even though she doesn't like anything. Why, I don't, who's that then? I don't know them.
Oh, yeah.
Well, this probably was on the last but one roll of film.
Right.
That I shot. And a great photographer from Bridgend called Geraint Radford.
Right.
Dropped me a line and said, there's someone's written Will You Marry Me in Pebbles on the hill in Southern Down again, sorry.
It's okay.
And he said, you should get down there. I think it would really fit into the project. So I went down, and as I was driving, if you've been to Southern Down, you drive down that steep hill, I could see it straight away. I thought, oh, that's brilliant. And then as soon as I got down into the car park, it was kind of like, oh, how am I going to take this? So I was standing on this wall that was about 6 or 7 foot high, and it was about like that, and the wind was blowing. And I had my little girl in the back of the car, wondering where I'd gone. And I was just, and I was trying to take this shot, and I just thought, oh, this is going to be a disaster. And I climbed down, and I went for a different angle. And then I thought, nah, I need to get back up on the wall. I don't think I got it. So I went back up onto the wall, and then onto my tiptoes. And I was just, oh, it was, how I'm still here today, I'll never know. But yeah, but it fitted into the project so well, because it was a suicide hotspot or something, yes, you know, yeah. Basically. And
on the cliff coming down.
Yeah, on the right hand side. Yeah. So, you know, there's both ends of the spectrum in there, you know. So it had to go in on that premise, you know. So, yeah, it was a nice, I think it dawned on me then, that's when the project was about to finish, you know.
Yeah, it's interesting. Do projects ever finish? I mean, your wife says you haven't finished.
I have, because the camera broke. So. No, I don't tease myself when I'm walking around Bridgend anymore, because, it was hard to get out with the routine of just looking, and it was painful. But now, it's completely different now, and I know not to go there anymore, just to leave it.
So the book, really, and the publishing of the book is the culmination of the, and the end, really.
Yeah. Well, I shot another roll of film after this, and the 11th frame of that roll of film, the camera just went and all jammed up, and I managed to get the roll of film out, and I thought to myself, this is a great time to just stop. So I won't get the camera repaired. This is it. So, and it was literally 2 or 3 weeks after that Ian from another place press sent me this email out of the blue saying, I'm starting this publishing company. Would you be interested in doing a small book? So it was like, yeah, definitely. The project's just finished. And he said, well, if the project's finished, let's make it 65 pages or whatever it was, and we put the whole thing in. And that's what happened.
How did you find the editorial process of putting a book together?
Ian, if he was here now, he'd probably kill me, because right in the middle of it, he says, right, we've got 6 weeks, or less than that maybe, we've got a month to select the pictures, and I wanted to rescan them all. So you'll rescan the pictures and sequence the shots, book layout, we've got a month. So I bought some work prints, 65 work prints, laid them all out on the table, left them here for 3 days, didn't do anything with them. It was really difficult. Sequencing is completely out of my league, I think. And he said, well, I can have a look at the sequencing for you. I said, oh, great. I said, oh, by the way, I'm going to Iceland tomorrow for the best part of 8 days. And he was, oh, okay. So he had to more or less do everything. Like, not even a rough edit. It was like the proper edit. And then when I came back, that's when I did the scanning, wasn't it? I spent about, about 50 hours of just scanning medium format negatives and getting the dust off them. And that took us to the edge a few times, didn't it? I won't mention it again. Or don't mention the scanning.
But Ian has, he must, he's very similar in style to you, the work he does.
Yeah, yeah.
So he must be very, he must have empathy for your way of working. And so were you pleased with his work when the book was...
Definitely. I couldn't believe how good a job he did with the sequencing, but he said he's a graphic designer by trade, so that he said that must have helped, you know. I had a bit of criticism off one of my friends who was kind of really outspoken and critical and said I should have gone for a more brutal edit with, like, for instance, a portrait of a couple next to the car crash as opposed to colours and compositions. Mm-hmm. But I was really happy with what he did, and I was happy to just let him have control of it, because it was out of my hands when we went to Iceland, because I just didn't have the technology to take with me, basically.
And what sort of run did you of the book was there?
What sort of?
How many were published?
Oh, 150.
Okay. Have you given one to Bridgend Council?
I wouldn't do. They wouldn't get it. Yeah, I should maybe post one to them.
Yeah, to the mayor.
Yeah, maybe. I know the mayor, funny enough. Well, he came to the show. When I showed Suicide Machine in Carnegie House in Bridgend, he actually came to the show.
Yeah, well, what sort of reaction did you get?
People were just kind of nonplussed, you know. What's this? Some guy even came up to me and said, how come you're not involved in that exhibition in town then? I said, I am. My stuff's there on the left as you go in. Oh, well, I saw your brother's work. I didn't see yours. I'd spent £200 on frames as well. I had to stick that on my credit card. But yeah, Ian was fabulous. And he runs the... because of the similarities in work... I'm obviously in his taste, and you look at his blog that he runs,
yeah,
and the photographers that he features, some of his outstanding, his curatorial
yeah,
eye, you know, and yeah, I was so happy to be involved, and I'd met him in real life as well, and of course he was one of the members of Document Britain, which is kind of like fading into the mist now, I suppose. But for a time, it was okay, you know?
Yeah.
So, so I'm hoping to meet up with him again this summer, because he lives right up in the sticks by Inverness. And what was the name of the place? Funny name, isn't it? But really interesting guy. If you can ever get to talk to him, I know you've tried. But he likes to hide himself away fortified house.
Is there one more shot after this?
There's not.
That's it?
That's it for the Suicide Machine stuff. There's that.
As far as publishing goes, I mean, you know, it's all about independence, really, isn't it? I mean, you wouldn't... If you took this to, for example, Gomer Press, which is kind of known as the Welsh publishers, they probably wouldn't look twice at it, would they?
They wouldn't, no.
Because they wouldn't understand it, they wouldn't get it.
Well, they wouldn't at all, I don't think. I'm always reluctant to submit to anything. I never enter competitions, I don't submit to magazines. I did when I was younger, but not anymore. And... I probably would never have submitted to any publishers either.
Right.
My critical friend, Ben, said, you should be ordering 50 copies, mate, and getting them everywhere. I was like, he said, I'll lend you the money. I was like, I just don't want to. I'm just happy with it. And that's it.
And you're a great collector of photographic books.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
How many have you got in your library, Dan?
In the dining room.
In the dining room.
There has to be, I'm not sure, 200,
250.
Are they big books? Yeah.
And how have they, I mean, it's really interesting that, you know, I guess most photographers have a collection of photographic books. Which is a kind of standout one in your collection that you would say this had a great influence on the way I think and I work as a photographer?
Oh, that's a good question. I suppose sometimes I go through a William Eggleston phase, sometimes an Alex Off phase.
Yeah.
Who else is in there? There's so many.
You said we were talking earlier.
Kudelka, yeah, the black and white stuff. A big influence because I suppose that's where it all started for me. Kudelka. I used to go up to Kylie on Library when my ex-girlfriend was doing meeting her tutor every Tuesday for coursework. I'd go into the library of the campus, and there'd just be this wealth of photo books. And it was Kudelka Exiles that I took home and sat there, just jaw to the floor. So if you haven't got that in your collection, I know he's got a good one in his collection. Where'd you live again?
So what was it specifically about Kudelka that triggered these things off in your head?
Well, I was familiar with Cartier-Bresson and his kind of geometric compositions. But I thought Kudelka did that, but also injected this kind of raw feeling of life in there as well, you know? He was right in the mix. He was in there pressing the shutter, and I really liked that. When you looked at the book, you kind of felt you could almost just step into the picture, you know? And I thought it was magical. Really.
And now your book is part of that collection in there.
Yeah, it's like smothered because it's only about that big. But it's in there somewhere.
I mean, the process of putting a book, a process of actually having a project. I mean, Suicide Machine is a long-term project. You know, you first started thinking about it in 2009, yeah? Am I right?
Yeah.
And it's now 2016, that's a long time.
There was a gap though.
And the gestation of it all.
There was a gap between 2009, I didn't get the Hasselblad until 2012. Right. So the project from beginning to end was 3.5 years of just relentless shooting of just About four rolls a week, three or four. Right. But then that was costing me, you know, the film was 25 quid for five rolls and 10 or each to get them developed.
Yeah.
It was starting to mount up. So that was another issue that it was costing so much money. Right. But
so the temptation was never there to go digital then?
No. No, people ask me about digital all the time, but I've always been film. Ever since I had my first SLR in 1994, film. I like the fact that it's a piece of celluloid that's physical. You can take a picture and it's on a piece of bloody plastic. You can hold up in front of your face. I just love that. But you know, I like the pace in which you work with film. If I would, you know, I shot in 3.5 years. I shot 250 pictures for Suicide Machine. I'm sure if that was digital, we'd have been looking at 1,250, you know?
Yes.
And then the editing would have just been an impossible task.
Yes.
So I'm thankful to film for that.
So will you put Suicide Machine to one side? Will you go back and revisit? Because sometimes when you revisit stuff, I find when you go back and look at stuff, I mean, I was looking at stuff the other day that I'd done, well, I don't know, 6 years ago.
Changes.
And it changes.
Yeah, yeah.
And you find new material that is, that you kind of passed you by in the first sort of, how often do you look at the stuff? You know, when you've got your film back.
Yeah.
And you're looking at it, how hard are you on yourself?
I'm quite strict. I suppose 99.9% of my photos no one has ever seen and will never see. And my and plus, my filing system is so terrible that you could never even find what you were looking for. Like, for instance, if someone, on the odd occasion, someone buys a print, like a, say a darkroom print, I will literally have to spend 3 hours looking for the negative through just, I've got these fruit baskets just full of sheets of negatives and I have to go through each one praying that it's going to be in the first basket, second basket. Oh, last basket, 3 hours later. There it
so
is.
You don't scan the stuff, once you've got your negs, you don't scan immediately?
No, never. I scan the ones I like. But I'll never scan the whole roll, no way.
But somebody's one day is going to go through your stuff, you know, they are, I mean, or will you get rid of it?
No. I'm pretty sure there's no hidden gold in there, though. It's just all, like, rubbish. Maybe the black and white stuff, there might be some stuff in there, but the colour stuff.
Are you tempted to, since you've, it's your first book, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. I'm last, probably.
Why do you say that?
I don't know, I just can't see anyone coming knocking again.
What project are you working on at the moment?
Well, there's a couple of things in the pipeline. I've been making a conscious effort to document family and close friends for the past 3 years. And I've been putting it in a file on iPhoto, because that's what I use. And every now and again, I'll take a look. And I looked a few days ago, and I'm thinking, my God, there's something growing here. There's some funny shots, more than anything. Okay. So I'm going to grow that. That's going to be something to look forward to for the family, because they won't have a clue what I've been shooting of them. They're going to be horrified, I know. Some of them. And I've been working on a project about the Bulch Mountain Pass that connects Bridgend to the Rhondda, yeah. Cwm Park. But that's slow at the moment.
And
but
is it that just landscape work, or is it more, is it detail?
Well, it
work
was starting, or? It was going to be landscape. I went for some wanderings and I thought I'm going to have to start making contact with the people, you know, in the villages either side.
Yeah.
So I emailed the vicar of Cwm Park. And he gets back to me, but he's really slow, and it's like weeks later, so I'm waiting for an email from him. And then hopefully he can put me in contact with someone. I think it would be a good project, you know?
Yeah, so it's immersive stuff that floats your boat, really.
Yeah, I suppose. And you know, I've only really been organising myself the last 7 years, since about 2009. I used to like shooting single shots, street photography, road trip stuff. And that's what I used to enjoy the most. But then I thought, I've got to start putting some context into these things and start putting stories together. So I suppose I'm pretty new to all this, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like an adventure, everyone.
Yeah, because really, that was really interesting listening to you talk about individual photographs, because you start seeing, obviously, your sort of the hidden metaphors that you were talking about. But there's all this layered stuff going on as well.
Yeah, definitely.
So
yeah,
is that a conscious thing, or do those things just happen sometimes?
I think it's a bit of both, isn't it? Sometimes you get lucky. Yeah. Sometimes you kind of, you know exactly what you're looking for and what you want. So, it's a bit of both, I suppose.
And
it's nice to have a bit of luck, isn't it?
Yeah.
Doesn't happen very often.
And you're a current exhibition up in Oriel Colwyn as well.
Yeah.
Did I mention Oriel Colwyn? Because they're listening to us.
Hello, Oriel Colwyn. I'll put the next picture on. Well, this is probably the first project I did when I was getting my shit together, you know? So I received an Arts Council grant for this. Strangely enough, we came back from India, was it? After being a couple of months out there. I thought, right, I'm going to start getting my act together now. So I emailed some galleries. Oh, I've got all this stuff. Anyone interested? One reply off Chris Wilson from Aberdeen. museum gallery. Right. Come and have a meeting. So I went up there. She said, yeah, I'll give you a show. You know, you'll have to, they'll have to be brand new work that takes a year. And yeah, whatever. I'll fill all the forms in for you. I was like, because they, well, you know about the forms, don't you, John? And they gave me £5,000, which I, to be fair, I spent entirely on film, paper, and chemicals, because I hand printed everything. Right. And I did buy myself a new camera, so which I was allowed to do. Yeah, so so there was a year then to shoot this project, which was just basically about Wales in the now, you know? Mm-hmm. So this was one of the earlier shots, Liam with his capri.
A black one?
Is it? Yeah, it was. And it was a 2.8 injection. Oh, it was a dog. It was, he was on, I think the capri was 23 or 24 years old and he was only 21. Just living in the past, this guy, completely, but really nice boy. And then about 2 weeks after this photo was taken, the car gave up the ghost and never saw it again. So I think it died. But I took this at the bottom of the street. He lived opposite. I didn't really know him that well, but he was willing to go down there. He took me in the car, and God, we went down the street. We only had to drive a quarter of a mile to the garages, and we must have gone about 80 miles an hour. It was terrifying. But yeah, nice guy.
So what did you learn about being what is Welsh? What did you learn anything about what we are?
I think we're pretty much like everyone else, to tell the truth. Yeah. And I look back at the project now, and it looks like we're kind of a little bit backward, if anything. Oh, we're very cosmopolitan. I show Liam standing by his like 25-year-old car. But it was just a...
I love this photograph, because this is storytelling, really. And this is the layered stories.
Yeah.
What's going on, you know?
Your guess is as good as mine, you know?
Yeah, but it's great, isn't it, you know?
It was... The strange thing about this photo is I used to meet up with another street photographer called Mike Crippen. And a good shooter. He shoots with a Russian rangefinder.
All right.
Really good street photographer.
A Zorky or something.
It was a Zorky, yeah. And we have exactly the same picture from slightly different angles.
Wow.
His is better than mine. Because he was a bit more around this way, so he's got the kind of, like half a side profile view. And his film developing was better than mine, so his looks crisper. And yeah, we must have pressed the shutter at exactly the same time.
Wow.
But what she was doing, I've no idea.
Watching this lady here.
So strange. So strange.
But these are sort of, I mean, yeah, that she makes the shot, really, doesn't she? I mean, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
It's wonderful, lovely. And where, where was that taken?
It's St. Mary's Street, isn't it?
St. Mary's Street, yeah.
So there's just about, I think there's about five of the best from what is Welsh. Ah, here we go. This is just a typical example of
I love
street photography,
yes,
you know.
At its best, yeah.
Just kind of looking for stuff like this.
Twist.
Brilliant. Yeah.
Interesting. Do you, because a tactic I kind of employ is that I will stay in one place and wait for things to happen around me.
Ah, right.
I kind of loiter, if you like.
Yeah, yeah.
And because you find a spot where something might happen. Or something
the background's
might,
nice. You want something to happen.
And something
in front
to
of it,
develop.
Yeah.
What sort of tactic do you use? Are you a free ranger? Just bang in
yeah,
there?
Yeah, I never hang about because I'm usually with her and she's gone. So I'm like, wait for me. So
he's the one that's gone.
But I bet if I see something, I'll rush ahead and then hang around for 30 seconds when she, for her to catch up and then TK Maxx then or something. Isn't it? So this was the Bridgend show.
I was just
It was kind of, but luckily it was F11.
Yeah.
And
you were.
I don't think it was pre-focused, but I was so lucky because I was dreading. But it's, I kind of like the fact that one dog's looking that way and that baby's looking that way, and then they're kind of looking at each other.
So much going on.
It's mirrored, isn't it? It's weird.
Yeah.
So strange. But it'd be interesting to find this couple with the twins and give them a print of that, or even the guy with the dogs. He'd have to pay. It's not quite as good. I'm always looking for compositions like this. These are the complex people crossing over each other. So this was a case of hanging around. Yeah. I did hang around kind of for this. We were watching something, I think, weren't we? Ah, it was the war reenactment in Caerleon.
Right.
And, oh no, Caldecott. And I turned round and there was just loads of stuff going on behind me, so I took a few shots, but that seemed to be the best.
Has he got a gun there?
Yeah, he's got a gun. There was also another picture I took, and two boys having a sword fight, and I couldn't choose which to choose. But then there's this guy. He was kind of creepy, this guy was. He kind of, he was living it, you know? He started grilling me about, do you know what rank I am? And I was just, I said, no, I've got a clue. He said, I am Schulter von Sons of the Luftwaffe or something.
Yeah,
but
so
he was serious.
Is that engagement with people important to you?
Yeah. Sometimes, I do like to have a little chat. As long as it doesn't go on too long, you know?
Yeah.
Sometimes.
It's a quick in and out job, really, isn't it?
Yeah, sometimes, like with this guy, I enjoyed the 1 minute chat, but then that was enough for me because he was, you know, there was something about him that was, yeah, you know, but he let me take the shot. That was the main thing. Yeah, I wish he kind of had these round John Lennon glasses on, and he took them off. Kind of wish he'd left them on.
Yeah,
it's really sinister. He had this white briefcase as well. Which was
white,
what was in that? I'll never know. It was just, who knows? It's packed lunch, probably.
And where was that taken?
This was Caldecott as well. It was on the same day as the last one.
Okay. That was a good day then. A good day of shooting.
Yeah. I think there was about half a dozen shots that I got that day. And this was Splot Market, Splo. And we'd seen this guy in Porthcawl previously with walking a giant lizard on a lead.
Yeah.
And I would put money on it that the guy's not alive now because he just looked awful. He just yellowy, pasty, grey. He was nice enough, spoke to him, can I take a photo of your parrot? Yeah, brilliant. And that was it. It was basically
boom.
Boom. Yeah. Thank you. Goodbye.
It's the pursing of the lips, isn't it?
Yeah. I don't know. I'm not sure if he was in the middle of saying something or I can't quite remember. But that didn't actually make it into the original show because with What is Welsh, I carried on shooting it for another year to just tidy it up a bit and get some better pictures.
And how far were you travelling with that project?
We went everywhere.
Okay.
Everywhere. Up to as far as Holyhead, you know?
Yeah.
And Flintshire, St. David's. Yeah. Towards the end of the, before I had to start the printing, because I had to give myself 3 months to print the photos, because there was 56 in all.
Right.
And they were all 20 by 16s. So in the summer, we did a 2 week road trip around Wales, camping, and brilliant. We think about that a lot, don't we? It was fabulous. Because the weather was, for the majority of the trip, it was 20, 25 degrees, and we were camping. It was brilliant. We were drinking wine in the night and shooting during the day. It's fabulous. But then by the time we got to North Wales, then he was pissing down. We had to chicken out then, didn't we? We got a hotel. But yeah, great memories from that trip, absolutely. I think that's the last one, yeah.
The last one.
Yeah. Unfortunately.
That's really cool. I'm going to open it out to the audience, actually.
Yeah, you can do.
Is that okay?
Yeah, of course, aye.
Anybody want to ask Dan any questions? Mr. Hudson? Oh, and the question is, I'll have to repeat so people in...
Oh, okay.
If somebody... Oh, could you...
if Hand of God came down with a cheque every month, would you do it full-time?
Yeah, would you become a full-time photographer?
Is that regarding like commercial work?
Yeah.
But I'm doing what you're doing now.
Ah, right. Oh, without a doubt, yeah.
Yeah.
I used to dabble with commercial work before, but... No, because it would be for myself, wouldn't it? It would be working as a kind of as an artist, I suppose, isn't it? As opposed to producing work for other people.
Yeah, but presumably it's not. I mean, all personal work is not about money, anyway.
Well, no, but
personal work. I'm a sort of job-in photographer. I have to earn a living from photography and I have to do the commercial rubbish that goes with it.
Yeah, yeah.
But my the stuff I do for myself, I would do forever.
Yeah, me too.
It's usually the best work we all make.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But there was a quote I read recently, and it said, to do the things that you want to do, you have to do the things that you don't want to do, you know? And it's so true, you know? But I'd rather work for my dad for a couple of days than do commercial photography, to tell the truth.
Yeah. Yeah, actually, I sometimes think it'd be nice to be a gardener for a while.
Yeah. And just something like that. Well, I've done menial jobs. I was a car valeter for a year, and...
Yeah.
When I was doing the What Is Welsh project, I was working as a car validator, and that was hard graft, but you know it was real. You know, I liked that, and I worked in a book warehouse.
Actually, there's a big series with car validating because they're everywhere now.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a potential there.
Definitely.
Giving stuff away here, but there's definitely a potential for that.
Yeah. And if anyone needs their car cleaned, you know. I'm pretty good.
Any more questions? Anybody want to ask anything else? By the way, while we're at it, Ian Sargent from another place, has got one copy in its cellophane wrap of Suicide Machine left. Now, as you know, we kind of do this work. We don't get any grants from anywhere. It's all for the love of it, isn't it, Brian? But, I mean, it's up 20 quid. And that's a bargain. So if anybody wants to buy a copy of Dan's book, the last one, this is the very
it's
last
the one. Last one in existence.
It is the very last one in existence.
Yeah, it must be.
And you could even take the cellophane off and have Dan... put his name on it for you. So anybody wants it, come and see us at the end, which is the end, really, I guess.
Thank you, Emma.
I would like to thank Dan for being so open and giving as a person. I think that comes over the more and more I get to know you as a guy.
Cheers.
So hands together and big claps for Dan.
Thank you.